Welcome to Public Health On Call, a podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. I'm Joshua Sharfstein, Vice Dean for Public Health Practice and Community Engagement, and a former health commissioner here in Baltimore. Our goal is to bring evidence and experience to illuminate critical public health issues. If you have questions or ideas for us, please send an email to publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu for future podcast episodes.
Hi, I'm Lindsay Smith-Rogers, producer of Public Health On Call. Today, the topic is COVID vaccines for children. Dr. Josh Sharfstein speaks with Johns Hopkins professor Ruth Karron, one of the world's leading experts in the development of children's vaccines. They discuss why it's taken so long to authorize vaccines for young children and what's likely to happen in the next few weeks. They also review the evidence on vaccinating children against COVID in the first place. Let's listen.
Dr. Ruth Karron, thank you so much for joining me on Public Health On Call for a topic that is near and dear to both of our hearts, childhood vaccination for COVID-19.
Thanks so much, Josh. It's really good to be with you.
So let's start with a basic question. We are now 2 years into the pandemic and well over a year after vaccines for adults became available, and there still aren't vaccines for the youngest children. Why has it taken so long?
Well, I think there are a couple of reasons. The first is that when we started in 2020 to make vaccines against COVID-19, at that time, early in 2020, I don't think we really appreciated the full burden of COVID-19 on young children. Certainly, we appreciated early on the indirect effects, the effects on schooling and other social activities. But I think it took us a while to really fully appreciate the direct medical effects of COVID. So I think that's part of it. I think really the second piece of it is you have to keep in mind that we're using a new vaccine platform for COVID-19 vaccines. We're using mRNA. And mRNA is new to us. It's highly effective, but it is also inflammatory. And I think anyone who's gotten these vaccines know that you can have low-grade fever, you can have chills and aches of various kinds. And one of the things that we know about children is that they're inflammatory reactions are heightened. I think we all know that young children get fevers, for example, much more frequently than adults do. And so the companies very appropriately and all of the bodies that regulate these vaccines really wanted to make sure that these vaccines were being evaluated as carefully and as safely as possible, just to ensure that a vaccine that would have an EUA would be safe to administer to children.
So really, it's not surprising that kids took later, because at the beginning it was clear it was older adults who were really at much higher risk from severe illness from COVID, and because it made sense to learn a lot more about these vaccines before giving them to the youngest kids.
That's absolutely right.
As the pandemic wore on, we learned a few things about COVID in kids, including that children could develop a pretty severe syndrome after COVID. How did that affect your thinking about the importance of a vaccine?
Well, this inflammatory response in children, this multi-system inflammatory disease, is severe and quite frightening, and we don't fully understand it yet, even now. It happens not during the acute infection, but shortly thereafter. And it certainly did make many people think that it might be important to develop a vaccine very early on. I think a number of people also wanted reassurance because this was understood to be an abnormal immune response to the virus, to make certain that vaccination wouldn't make that worse. And in fact, one of the things we've learned that's important as we've used vaccine in adolescents and in children over age 5 is that, in fact, it decreases the rate of this rare condition called MISC. It certainly doesn't exacerbate that. So that's reassuring. But I think to answer your question, For me personally, I think the case for COVID vaccination of children became clearest. It started with Delta in the late summer and early fall of 2021. And certainly by the time we got to Omicron, where hospitalizations for children were surging, I think the case became very clear. And part of that is related to how we think about numbers of people who are susceptible and numbers of people who get serious infection and get hospitalized.
I want to ask you about that. So we often hear, well, children are just so much less likely to get sick. So why bother vaccinating them? That seems to be almost the official position of the Surgeon General of the state of Florida. But certainly on social media, people are wondering. And in fact, among younger kids, less than half of them have been vaccinated, even the ones who are eligible. So parents are clearly wondering what the point is. So as we've learned more about this inflammatory syndrome and the benefits of vaccination to prevent it, and the threat of Delta and Omicron to kids, explain your view on whether children should be vaccinated.
So the thing is, this virus is smarter than we ever imagined. Who would have thought? I remember saying to somebody in 2020, this virus has really got it made. It's really infectious. You know, it transmits really well. We had no clue. The transmissibility of those early isolates of SARS-CoV-2 compared to, Omicron and its variants, which are more transmissible than measles, one of the most infectious diseases we know of. What that means is that many people are going to get infected. Virtually everybody is going to get infected with this virus sooner or later. And what that means is that even if complications in children are rare, if everybody is getting infected, the absolute number of children who will have serious disease or who will die is not a small number. So right now, the CDC estimates that 1,200 children have died of COVID, 1,200 children. And we're talking for the most part about generally healthy children or children with minor medical issues. So this is a tragedy. And whatever we can do to avoid this tragedy is something we should do.
So, what you're saying is a lot of childhood illnesses, for any one child, the risk may be low. But if you look across a lot of children, you see some pretty severe outcomes. And that's just such an awful thing to happen, that vaccinating everyone to protect those kids makes sense, particularly when you don't know if the dice could come up and that kid is yours.
Exactly. And I also think, while I completely agree that what we call the NPIs, the non-pharmaceutical interventions, masking, and those sorts of interventions are important, and as we need to, we should continue to mask. The truth of the matter is, people also do need to continue to lead their lives. Children 100% need to be in school. Children need to be playing sports, and congregating. This is part of childhood. And our children have lost time. They've lost years to this pandemic in a much more profound way than adults have lost years to this pandemic.
Well, I think that is a compelling case, and it is why the Academy of Pediatrics and the Centers for Disease Control really do support childhood immunization to avoid pretty severe complications, not only directly from the virus, but also this inflammatory syndrome that can be caused by the virus. Now, there are certainly some parents who have gotten the message. They're very interested in vaccinating their kids. They vaccinated all their eligible children, but they have young kids who haven't been able to get vaccinated, and they are frustrated because they're worried about them and they want to know when vaccines will be available. What do we know about vaccinating the youngest children?
Well, we know that the two companies in the U.S. that produce mRNA vaccines, Moderna and Pfizer, have each applied to the FDA for an emergency use authorization, an EUA. And the FDA is reviewing these applications and will hold public meetings with its advisory committee, VRBPAC, in June. We don't know the exact dates yet, but the FDA has committed to the fact that they will be reviewing both of these applications in June. And so we're very hopeful that sometime next month, we will have one or both of these vaccines available for use in children.
That's a pretty optimistic view. There have been some challenges with these trials to date.
There have been. So in particular, I think many people probably know about the Pfizer trial, which was originally for most normal healthy adults and older children, what we consider a primary series of vaccination is two doses of vaccine. And Pfizer was understandably very cautious in its dosing of vaccines for the very youngest children. And so for those very young children, the dose for children under 6 months to 4 years of age was a tenth of the dose given to adults, so 3 micrograms instead of 30 micrograms. And what happened in the early part of this year is that Pfizer discovered that actually it was safe, but did not quite produce the same immunity that they had seen in older children and adults. So their product, they've actually gone ahead and given a third dose of vaccine to this very youngest age group. And that's what they've applied for authorization to the FDA for. The Moderna vaccine is given as a two-dose series.
Got it. And for a little while, there was some question about whether FDA was waiting for both to be ready for review, but the agency has recently clarified that it's going to review them as soon as they can.
Yes, I think appropriately, the agency has heard loud and clearly from groups like the American Academy of Pediatrics and from parents themselves that the time is now to really consider these applications so that these youngest children can be protected. They are in the process of reviewing all of the data. I mean, there are challenges, of course, with these very young children because you absolutely want these vaccines to be as safe as possible. But the other thing that's complicated is you're always looking at antibody and sometimes a little bit of efficacy data against virus that's perpetually changing. So interpreting the data, not the safety data, but interpreting the immune response and the efficacy is a little bit more challenging.
Yeah, I'm going to run something by you here. I think this is a very challenging, you know, scientific question. The various studies and the doses have got to be worked out very carefully. To me, it is understandable why it's taken so long. But what is less understandable is how little FDA has said to the public about it. I think the FDA has taken a very traditional approach of letting the companies do the talking and being very diligent about reviewing the data on the back end and kind of waiting for the approval or authorization in this case to really start to make more significant public disclosures. But I don't think that approach really has worked that well. I think it's probably led companies to be raising and dashing hopes of parents without a steady voice from people who would be able to help steer parents to really understanding what's going on. Do you think that's fair? Do you think that's a reasonable criticism of the FDA?
Well, I think what would be helpful is if the FDA had articulated what they probably were thinking, but just not sharing, which is we want to have a plan to protect people from 6 months up through the rest of their lives. And we've started with adults. We've started with some high-risk groups. We are working our way down. We are committed to this. We are going slowly and carefully for the reasons we've articulated before. This is a brand new kind of vaccine, and we need to be as careful as possible. But we understand the need, and we are working with the companies. In other contexts, I think, during this pandemic, the FDA has been very proactive, right? Issuing guidance for EUAs and for licensure and all of those sorts of things. And I think it's just not communicating what was probably their intent all along.
I agree with that. And I think I'm very much looking forward to all the disclosure that will happen as part of the advisory committee meetings and people really getting to see the great work that has been going on within FDA, the thoughtfulness that has been brought to that. I think, you know, having worked at the FDA myself, I appreciate all of that and how much has been going on. And sometimes I just wish they had been in a position to share more of it with the public, but especially during these last few months, which have been so stressful for parents.
I agree.
Well, Dr. Karron, thank you so much. We're going to be watching very carefully this advisory committee meeting in June. And with any luck, we'll have some vaccines for kids 6 months and up, not too long.
Thanks. I absolutely hope so.
Public Health on Call is produced by Joshua Sharfstein, Lindsay Smith-Rogers, and Stephanie Desmond. Audio production by J.B. Arbogast, Holly Cardinal, Spencer Greer, and Matthew Martin, with support from Chip Hickey. Distribution by Nick Moran. Production support from Catherine Ricardo. Social media run by Grace Holes Fernandez and Amber Bryan Singletary. Thank you for listening.